Here is a colony of bacteria. Everything looks normal, right? Well, what if I told you that the DNA inside these cells is entirely man-made? Yes, that's right. This might sound like science fiction, but it's not. This is the world of synthetic biology. The story of synthetic genomics begins with scientists exploring the question of what are the minimum genes required for survival? The Minimum Genome Project began in 1995 when a team of scientists sequenced the genome of Mycoplasma genitalium, which has one of the smallest genomes of any self-replicating cell, with just 580,076 base pairs and 525 genes. In 2006, the team determined that 100 of Mycoplasma genitalium's coding genes were individually non-essential, but they did not know how many of these genes were dispensable together. They proposed synthetic bacterial genomes could help to explore this. However, while scientists had previously assembled viral DNA genomes, synthesizing the larger genomes of bacteria had yet to be successfully achieved. That was until 2008, when Daniel Gibson successfully chemically synthesized and assembled the synthetic Mycoplasma genitalium genome. Gibson and his team began with the genomic DNA fragmented into 101 cassettes, 5 to 7,000 base pairs in length. Each cassette contained terminal sequences that overlapped the neighboring DNA in the circular genome, and 5 also had additional watermark sequences to help identify the synthetic genome. Another insertion was also added into a gene to inhibit pathogenicity. So now the team had the DNA fragments, how could they assemble them? Gibson designed a 5-stage assembly that gradually joined the DNA together to create larger and larger segments until the complete genome was formed. The first 3 stages consisted of cloning adjacent DNA fragments into the backbone of a plasmid vector. To do this, an exonuclease was used to chew back the 3' overlap sequences to expose an overhang complementary to the 5' end of the adjacent DNA fragment. Heating, then cooling the reaction annealed the overlapping regions together, and DNA polymerase and ligase were used to repair the annealed joints. This results in the cassettes joined together within a plasmid, which could be transformed into E. coli and grown into a culture to amplify the DNA for the next assembly stage. However, this method was only successful for forming up to 1/4 pieces of the genome, and so the final 2 stages were completed in Saccharomyces cerevisiae, also known as brewer's yeast. The pieces of the genome were assembled into an artificial yeast chromosome that was transformed into cerevisiae to join the pieces together. Sequencing the resulting DNA confirmed the project's success. The first synthetic bacterial genome had been created. This was a great advancement in synthetic biology that not only led to Gibson's team creating the world's first synthetic self-replicating cell in 2010, but also the completion of the Minimum Genome Project in 2016, with the creation of a minimal Mycoplasma mycoides cell that contained just 531,000 base pairs and 473 genes. However, uses for synthetic genomics extends beyond the Minimum Genome Project. For example, in 2019, a minimized Colobacter crescenta genome was rewritten with synonymous codons and protein coding genes and non-synonymous substitutions elsewhere to create Colobacter ethensis 2.0. Despite limiting gene elements like alternative open reading frames and DNA sequence patterns, testing the genome in segments showed that a majority of edits appeared to maintain gene functionality, although some others did cause loss of functions. But some of these losses actually revealed new gene elements, as well as errors in the published notes on the Colobacter crescenta gene functions. This demonstrates how synthetic genomes can be used to validate what we know about the function of native genomes. Also in 2019, the synthetic E. coli strain SYN61 was created, which used just 61 codons, as the serine codons TCG and TCA and the TAG stop codon were replaced with synonymous ones. SYN61 cells show similar functionality to natural E. coli cells, revealing life is possible without the natural 64 codon set. The spare codons could be used to encode for non-standard amino acids and allow for the engineering of genomes to possess new biological functions that could assist in a wide range of industries. Over the past 2 decades, we've seen considerable advances, but we're still only at the very beginning of the synthetic genome story. The initial time-consuming and expensive assembly process has hindered the widespread use of synthetic genomes. However, the potential uses of synthetic bacteria are endless. For decades, we've used bacteria to produce vital compounds like insulin, but imagine the day when we can design bacteria to produce other things like new medicines or biofuels. Synthetic genomes could also be applied to current research around engineering bacteria to help detect or treat a range of conditions like other bacterial infections, diabetes, or even cancers. But for now, we will just have to wait and see what the next chapter brings.